We are going to transition in having a moment to reflect on what we've just experienced together. We are going to have a few colleagues just kind of resonate and reflect for us on our time with Michelle Alexander and do some short readings. This is a segment that is titled Reading for Truth and Justice. So I'm going to turn it over to the colleagues who will be participating in this reading aloud.
Challenging mass incarceration requires something civil rights advocates have long been reluctant to do: advocacy on behalf of criminals. Even at the height of Jim Crow segregation, when Black men were more likely to be lynched than to receive a fair trial in the South, NAACP lawyers were reluctant to advocate on behalf of Blacks accused of crimes unless the lawyers were convinced of the men's innocence. Advocates have found they are most successful when they draw attention to certain types of Black people, those who are easily understood by mainstream whites as good and respectable, and tell certain types of stories about them. Since the days when abolitionists struggled to eradicate slavery, racial justice advocates have gone to great lengths to identify Black people who defy racial stereotypes, and they have exercised considerable message discipline, telling only those stories of racial injustice that will evoke sympathy among whites. We can continue to ignore those labeled criminal in our litigation and media advocacy and focus public attention on more attractive plaintiffs, like innocent doctors and lawyers stopped and searched on freeways, innocent Black and brown school children attending abysmal schools, or innocent middle and upper middle class Black children who will be denied access to Harvard, Michigan, and Yale if affirmative action disappears. We can continue on this well-worn path, but if we do so, we should labor under no illusions that we will end mass incarceration or shake the foundations of the current racial order. We may improve some school districts, prolong affirmative action for another decade or two, or force some police departments to condemn racial profiling, but we will not put a dent in the prevailing caste system. We must face the realities of the new caste system and embrace those who are most oppressed by it if we hope to end the new Jim Crow.
Hi, everyone. I was deeply, deeply moved by Michelle Alexander's talk. So I just want to start with saying that. I'm actually reading an excerpt from another book in dialogue with her work, and I'll be reading an excerpt later from her book a bit later. I was deeply moved, especially in thinking about for Black people, for marginalized people, the ways in which, because of these systems of policing, we live in a state of being second-class citizens. So what happens to our memories, our thoughts? And this excerpt from Salamisha Tillett's book, Sites of Slavery, is how, especially for Black people, the arts often become a place to express citizenship when they've been denied those full forms of citizenship. And so I'll go ahead and read a quote from this book. So Tillett writes, "By doing so, African Americans not only call the legitimacy of American civic myths into question, but also reconfigure these civic markers in order to accommodate the constitutive sites of American history that the national memory has forgotten or excised. To combat this erasure and elision, contemporary Black cultural producers engage in what Charles Taylor aptly terms, quote, the politics of recognition, end quote, the formal battle for equality that requires a revision of symbols and images. Whereas the debates for legal citizenship largely took place in the juridical and political realms, civic membership is symbolic in form. The demands for civic membership, therefore, have mostly taken place in aesthetic and cultural realms. As Ralph Ellison puts it, quote, the society is not likely to become free of racism. Thus, it is necessary for Negroes to free themselves by becoming their idea of what a free people should be, end quote. In order to gain this Ellisonian freedom, post-civil rights African Americans have attached themselves to the myths, monuments, narratives, icons, creeds, and images that render them eligible for civic membership. They do so precisely by revising the very same elements of national identity from which they have been rejected. Those most likely to engage the abstract signs and symbols that make up the national identity have been contemporary African American artists, writers, and legislators whose projects, contexts, the hegemony and racial homogeneity of African civic myths while simultaneously creating more historically faithful and more democratic national narratives.
Thank you so much, Professor Mahmoud. This afternoon, I'm grateful to be able to read a short and abridged passage from Freedom is a Constant Struggle, a 2016 book by activist and philosopher Angela Davis. If the intersectionality of struggles against racism, sexism, homophobia, and transphobia is minimized, we will never achieve significant victories in our fight for justice. This is yet another reason why it is essential to develop richer and more critical vocabularies with which to express our insights about racism. The popularization of more complex analyses of racism, especially those that have been developed in the context of Black and women of color feminisms, can assist us to understand how deeply embedded racist violence is in our country's economic and ideological structures. These ways of talking about racism can also help us grasp the global reach of our struggles. For example, Palestinian Americans' involvement in the Ferguson protests was complemented by the expressions of solidarity with Ferguson from Palestinian activists in the West Bank and Gaza. The Ferguson struggle has taught us that local issues have global ramifications. Deep understandings of racist violence arm us against deceptive solutions. When we are told that we simply need better police and better prisons, we counter with what we really need. We need to reimagine security, which will involve the abolition of policing and imprisonment as we know them. We will say demilitarize the police, disarm the police, abolish the institution of the police as we know it, and abolish imprisonment as the dominant form of punishment. But we will only have just begun to tell the truth about violence in America.
Thank you, Dr. Cisneros. The extract I've chosen is from Layla F. Saad's Me and White Supremacy, Combat Racism, Change the World, and Become a Good Ancestor. The book was on last year's summer reading list from the Office of Diversity and Inclusion. And to provide some context, the author describes herself as an East African, Arab, British, Black, Muslim woman who was born in and grew up in the UK and currently lives in Qatar. She addresses her readers throughout as you, and her book is a provocation and a challenge that calls readers, and in particular white readers, to reflect on their racist thoughts and behaviors and to commit to change for racial equity. And as we're all feeling rather exhausted at this point in the pandemic, I've chosen a segment on white apathy that I keep revisiting to regalvanize action. She writes, "White apathy arises as a self-preservation response to protect yourself from having to face your complicity in the oppression that is white supremacy. But like white silence, white apathy is not neutral. It's easy to judge intentional and planned out acts of racism as the only manifestation of white supremacy. However, the intentional non-action of white apathy is just as dangerous as these intentional acts of racism. Through detachment and indifference to racial harm, white apathy says, it's really sad that this is happening to you, but it's not my problem. White apathy therefore tries to enforce this idea that white supremacy is a problem inherent to BIPOC and not a problem created and maintained by people with white privilege. White apathy says to BIPOC, I wish I could help you with your cause, but unfortunately, I'm just too busy right now. Unfortunately, I'm just too tired right now. But maybe when I can clear a bit more space for myself, I can make some more time to come and help you out. But until then, all the best. But dismantling white supremacy isn't a charitable cause. White supremacy is a system of oppression that confers unearned advantages and privileges to one group of people at the expense of other groups of people. White apathy is the choice to stay in the warm and safe comfort of white supremacy and the privileges that it affords. So here are three examples of white apathy in action. One, using your high sensitivity, high introversion, or mental health and personal issues to opt out of doing the work, ignoring the fact that there are BIPOC who are also highly sensitive, highly introverted, and of mental health and personal issues who cannot opt out of being at the receiving end of your racism. Two, overcomplicating what it takes to practice anti-racism, using various excuses that allow you to procrastinate or become overwhelmed by the work that needs to be done. Three, using perfectionism to avoid doing the work and fearing using your voice or showing up for anti-racism work until you know everything perfectly and can avoid being called out for making mistakes. To fight against white apathy is to fight against white supremacy, to resist the urge to make excuses, stay detached, retreat into silence, and avoid responsibility, and instead to accept the complexities of this work is to show up for the practice of anti-racism.
Thank you, David. I will read from Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow. This section invites us to look at our very own city of Seattle. In 2002, a team of researchers at the University of Washington decided to take the defenses of the drug war seriously by subjecting the arguments to empirical testing in a major study of drug law enforcement in a racially mixed city, Seattle. The study found that, contrary to the prevailing common sense, the high arrest rates of African Americans in drug law enforcement could not be explained by rates of offending, nor could they be explained by other standard excuses, such as the ease and efficiency of policing open-air drug markets, citizen complaints, crime rates, or drug-related violence. The study also debunked the assumption that white drug dealers deal indoors, making their criminal activity more difficult to detect. The authors found that it was untrue stereotypes about crack markets, crack dealers, and crack babies, not facts, that were driving discretionary decision-making by the Seattle Police Department. The facts were as follows. Seattle residents were far more likely to report suspected narcotics activities in residences, not outdoors, but police devoted their resources to open-air drug markets and to the one precinct that was least likely to be identified as the site of suspected drug activity in citizen complaints. In fact, although hundreds of outdoor drug transactions were recorded in predominantly white areas of Seattle, police concentrated their drug enforcement efforts in one downtown drug market where the frequency of drug transactions was much lower. In racially mixed open-air drug markets, Black dealers were far more likely to be arrested than whites, even though white dealers were present and visible. Thank you.
Great, thank you. And for the last reading, I'll also be reading from The New Jim Crow. Today, no less than 50 years ago, a flawed public consensus lies at the core of the prevailing caste system. When people think about crime, especially drug crime, they do not think about suburban housewives violating laws regulating prescription drugs or white frat boys using ecstasy. Drug crime in this country is understood to be Black and brown, and it is because drug crime is racially defined in the public consciousness that the electorate has not cared much about what happens to, quote, drug criminals, at least not the way they would have cared if the criminals were understood to be white. It is this failure to care, really care across color lines, that lies at the core of the system of control and every racial caste system that has existed in the United States or anywhere in the world. Those who believe that advocacy challenging mass incarceration can be successful without overturning the public consensus that gave rise to it are engaging in fanciful thinking, a form of denial. Isolated victories can be won, even a string of victories, but in the absence of a fundamental shift in public consciousness, the system as a whole will remain intact. To the extent that major changes are achieved without a complete shift, the system will rebound. The caste system will re-emerge in a new form, just as convict leasing replaced slavery, or it will be reborn just as mass incarceration replaced Jim Crow. Thank you.
Thank you to all those who offered those very powerful reflections. And what a powerful day thus far. Again, my gratitude to Michelle Alexander and to Natasha Martin for such an engaged conversation. We're now moving into what is a panel of campus leaders and those of us who are in leadership. So this is a commitment to lead for racial equity and anti-racism. And I will serve as the facilitator. We are blessed to have both our current president, Father Steve Sundborg, our president-elect, Eduardo Peña-Alver, with us, along with Vice President for Student Development, Alvin Studevant, the chair of our Board of Trustees, Nicole Piasecki, the Dean of our College of Arts and Sciences, David Powers, the Dean of our Libraries, Sarah Watstein, and as I said, I'll be serving as the facilitator. So I want to frame this, well, first of all, I just want to acknowledge that there's seven of us serving on this panel, and as leaders, we can at times be very loquacious. So I would invite and ask that we keep our remarks to be focused and to about 1 to 2 minutes each time we speak so that we can really be quite focused. So this is a leadership panel, and most of the people on this call were present at the time that LiftSU was launched. And at that time, as leaders, members of the president's cabinet or members of the dean's council, we were asked to consider a set of commitments as leaders that we would make towards racial justice and anti-racist education. And of course, this day is framed in part as a day of listening and learning, but it also needs to lead us to action. And so as we have this conversation for the next 45 minutes or so, I ask all of our panelists to think about our role as a leader and the commitments that we make as leaders and how we are accountable for those. So my first opening question is just a general question. As you're reflecting on the day thus far, on the Racial Equity Summit, and particularly the conversation between Natasha Martin and Michelle Alexander and our leadership role, what is the strongest impression and the strongest moment that came up for you either in the conversation or today? And Alvin, I'm actually going to start with you, if you could jump in and maybe share something on that.
Thank you, Provost Martin. So certainly the conversation between Natasha and Michelle resonated with me for a variety of different reasons, the least of which is my own sort of personal sort of connection with the references that were made throughout. I think it's pretty obvious to everyone, and I've spoken about this in other settings, that I am Black and African-American and come from a family with roots in the Caribbean. And so I've also had the opportunity to utilize Michelle's book in a course that I taught in the Department of Sociology here at Seattle University. And so when I think about the conversation that took place between the two of them, think about it in the context of my leadership, but also in the context of my personal life. I'm leading at a time when the worth of people who look like me and the folks that Michelle and Natasha were talking about earlier are constantly under fire, when to leave my own home each day presents a risk to my life and to my safety, when the murder of those who also look like I do has been sanctioned by unjust policing and legal decisions. That it's not an easy thing to do and or to think about necessarily. And yet, you know, I find it necessary and necessary for all the reasons that the two of them talked about earlier. I think it's important because, representation matters and showing up as a Black person, as a BIPOC person in leadership on this campus, doing so every day matters because, you know, my voice matters, Black lives matter, BIPOC lives matter, but also not only for my own benefit, but also because of the kind of campus that we aspire to and what we're attempting to create in terms of diversity, inclusion, and equity, and how those can serve as threads that really bind all of us together on this campus, both in relationship and in our work. There's so much richness and depth to what was offered, you know, talking about mass incarceration and mass deportation. When I think about it from a personal perspective, specifically incarceration, certainly, you know, that was the expectation that many, particularly those who had very limited engagement and interactions with Black men, had for me in my life. And yet, that's not my narrative nor my story, but I'm also quite aware that in many spaces that I'm in, you know, that certainly is the dominant narrative. And part of, you know, my work is to break that narrative down and to create a new one so that folks understand that there's not this monolith associated with, you know, being a Black man in this world, and in particular on this campus. So, you know, as I reflect on the conversation between Natasha and Michelle Alexander, that's more immediately where my head went.
Alvin, thank you. Powerful, personal, and connects just so many things for today. Thank you. Eduardo, I'd love to hear your perspective from today.
So, you know, a really powerful moment for me was during the allyship panel. I think it was Michelle Kim spoke about the sense that when you think you have gotten there, then you've gone wrong somehow. You know, this idea of, you know, allyship as a continuous process of growth and development. And I was thinking about the Lift SU goals and this, to me, the most important and challenging commitment within that plan is this idea of a shift towards a growth mindset that includes constant improvement and the need to kind of constantly be seeking and creating a more inclusive university community. And that commitment involves a lot of risk-taking and a kind of willingness to fail forward, as the plan puts it. And I think it requires us to always be open to our own fallibility, and requires us to always be open to listening and learning, as you mentioned. And I, you know, I've been doing that, you know, all day today, and really listening and learning from the conversation with obviously the really powerful keynote, the conversation between Natasha and Michelle Alexander. And, you know, I think it sort of relates in an important way to what's unique about universities in this moment. You know, universities are kind of unique places for people to engage in reasoned disagreement. And that's really an important part of this process of constantly improving. And, you know, universities are committed to us, a fearless search for the truth. And in engaging in that search, we always need to acknowledge that none of us have all the answers. We all have something to learn from one another. And so part of that process of seeking truth and pursuing justice is learning to listen, learning to listen, and also to express ourselves in ways that are open to others and to that dialogue. So that conversation about just the kind of our fallibility that allyship panel engaged in was really powerful for me. I just want to add before I give you back the spotlight, I just want to thank you for including me in this, and also want to congratulate Vice President Martin for putting this together and the staff in her office and in your office, Shane, and the IT staff. What an amazing, just the logistics of this have been blowing my mind. So I just want to congratulate everyone for putting together a really powerful day.
Great. Well, thank you, Eduardo. And we are all heartened as our president-elect that you highlighted the listening and learning mode as you embrace Seattle U Evermore. We look forward to your July 1 start date. Nicole Paisecki, you serve as chair of our Board of Trustees, which is the governance or fiduciary board that oversees Seattle U. And of course, you're also quite a leader in the Puget Sound. You've had a distinguished career as a senior business leader. What do you take from these conversations today? Nicole, let's get you unmuted and start that again. Yeah, there we go.
Okay, I'm fighting that great IT team, trying to unmute myself, and they are at the same time. Let me just first say how proud I am to be associated with this event and to see the collective power of everyone coming together and creating this great dialogue, which is so consistently about who we are. You're right, as chair of the board, we are a governing body. We do have fiduciary responsibilities. So why then, or how can we make a difference in this overall effort? And do we care, and are we involved? And the answer to those questions are absolutely yes. In fact, it's our duty to ensure that we are enabling our mission of a just and humane world. And it's us who bear ultimate responsibility and accountability for the creation of an open and safe campus. And what I heard, what I have heard today is just representative of that open, caring, and safe place where we're all dialoguing. I would say the conversation between Professor Alexander and Natasha was, for me, moving in the calmness of the dialogue and yet the powerfulness of the words. Because really her work is about reframing our societal truths, and to be able to speak openly about that and let the mind readjust is it's very, very powerful to me. So again, thank you and everyone for hosting this and including me as a representative of the board.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Nicole. Father Steve, I'll turn to you, 24th president of Seattle University, coming into the very home stretch of an incredible legacy. What moved you today, or what did you take from the day thus far? And let's get you unmuted as well.
Yeah, I just got muted. There, I'm off.
Okay.
I just love the very start from the beginning with the acknowledgements and sort of set the pace for the day in terms of how it developed from there. I also was impressed by the data that Irina Voloshin was able to give us about Seattle University after Natasha had sort of talked about our context. That was new information to me. It's encouraging, got ways to go, but very interesting kind of to know that information. I too was taken, Eduardo, with the discussion about the allyship and stewardship and that what went on in that dialogue there with the people. And I love the line there about, you know, when you don't want to bring along the other annoying white supremacists, don't forget you're one of them. So it's kind of like bring along yourself and don't forget to bring along the others. You're not necessarily already arrived. And if you are arrived, you're probably going to be a problem for others. I thought that was a powerful segment. You know, the time that was given for our personal reflection probably shows that I'm a person that processes things when I have a little bit of time by myself or quiet. Was powerful for me, just going back over my own narrative and how that's informed the way in which I engage with others. And, you know, I took almost the full time on that, and a little bit around how much do I have personal knowledge of others rather than simply reading about or knowing about through other kinds of other means. And that too was important for me in terms of what the day has been about. You know, the other view I have, and it came up several times during the day, was about have we changed during the course of this year or not? And my own view on that is I do believe we've changed. It's hard to measure the change in culture. And I just believe that all of us are far more aware and sensitive than we had been a year ago. I think we're much more knowledgeable about what the influence of particularly Black persons in our history in America have been than we would have been a year ago. I think that we've brought forward some laws and policies and structures and systems that are changing America. And I believe that you can see in our overall culture the difference. I don't think a year ago, when people would say, is this going to be just for a moment or is this going to be ongoing? I don't think we would have believed that next Tuesday will be the first anniversary of the murder of George Floyd. I don't think we would have believed we would be here and as much would have carried on during the course of this year in terms of the adjustment of our culture. If we have more years like this in the adjustment and the change of our culture, I think that we will significantly impact both the nation and also Seattle University. I sort of think of it as, you know, each of us has to do what we can do from our position. So part of my role as president of the university is support what others are doing and support the outcomes from the Task Force on Diversity and Inclusion and support where we are with our strategic directions and support the work of Natasha Martin and support having a day like this rather than our usual kind of a mission day. And that's action on behalf of what we're about. So I thought it was just a phenomenal day. And those are the things that stood out most for me in it. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks, Father Steve. I appreciate that. Sarah, I'd love to hear your reflections.
Thank you, Shane. You know, there are a couple of powerful things for me. Dr. Alexander's comment about everything has changed and yet, and it brought me back to the early 80s and the mid 80s. And I was living in New York and I was involved from the beginning with ACT UP, which was the AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power, which was a nonpartisan group of individuals united in anger and committed to direct action to end the AIDS crisis, direct action and dialogue. And I look at the through line of activism in my life and, you know, the question, everything has changed, but it's 2021 and what has changed? And I found myself really thinking during the time for reflection, you know, what to me is America? And is America the people that now inhabit the land divorced from our systems and history? Or is it inclusive of our systems and history? So that was powerful reflection on activism. And the other, and I'm grateful for Dr. Alexander. I had never put these pieces together. I am a Jewish woman, and Dr. Alexander was talking about the spiritual journey of this work. And I thought of the Hebrew phrase tikkun olam, which means world repair. And today, in modern terms, it's synonymous with social action and the pursuit of social justice. And I had never seen that through line in my life as an activist. So I'm, you know, those were powerful moments for me. Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah. Love that notion of world repair. It's powerful. David.
Sure, thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to be part of this conversation. It's definitely been a powerful day for me, you know, hearing Michelle Alexander and Vice President Martin talk about the book and what's happened since then. The conversation she had that sparked everything with the gentleman who, at the end of the conversation, she found out he was a felon and then had to, and then said, "I'm sorry, I can't help you." Sort of hearing someone who's such a leader. Hearing their own growth story and where it came from and where things maybe fell short or there wasn't understanding at the beginning, that was uplifting for me as someone who feels like I'm behind and trying to catch up on in so many ways on so much of this. So I very much appreciated that story and their whole conversation. And the allyship piece, I mean, talking about how to authentically do this and not just to, you know, oh, the piece about students being sort of coming in a different place than where we are. It's much like technology where the next generation of students comes in and we have experts who are ahead of those students, but most of us maybe are not. I think we're at that place in our culture right now with anti-racist work where we have a lot of experts who've been here for decades, but most of us are not ahead of a place where many of our students are. But the allyship component in that conversation, I found really concretely helpful for me in thinking about how we move forward for the work that's been going on for decades, for the work the university started to take on in the last, 8 years, and how we go forward from here.
Thanks, David. I agree. One of the things I most appreciated about Professor Alexander's remarks was her candor, and as Natasha mentioned, her vulnerability in sharing her own story, her own journey, her own growth points. As we all know, in her book, she talks about where she, the book was originally published in 2010, and she talked about where she was in 2000 and before, and very much immersed in the narratives that, well, if someone was incarcerated, it was because they deserved it, and, you know, sort of the us and them, and how her personal experience changed her heart and changed her mind. And I think she went deeper with us on that today, very, very powerful. And then, of course, as been noted in the recent update to her 2010 book, she even puts more insight as she makes the connection between mass incarceration and mass deportation as how the evolution of the new Jim Crow. You, Father Steve, you talked about the data that was shared by Irina Voloshin, and I too was struck by the data, because it gave us a snapshot of different aspects of our community. It should be lost on no one that as we prepare to welcome next year's first time in college and transfer class, that it will be the most diverse class in the history of Seattle University. And I think many of the numbers that Irina shared point to that trajectory, and we know that trend will only continue. And yet some of the other numbers tell us that we do have a gap when we look at our faculty and staff who identify as BIPOC and the gaps with our students. And so I'm wondering to the panel, as leaders at Seattle University, what are the ways that we can both help this university prepare to be the place where all of our students, faculty, and staff can be successful, particularly in terms of the greater diversity that we will have? And that's diversity on multiple planes, race, ethnicity, but first gender, first generation college, religious diversity, et cetera. So intersectionality as well as all of those. And the gap issue that I'm talking about with our faculty and our staff. And so, you know, it's a student issue, it's a faculty issue, it's a staff issue, it's a culture issue for us at Seattle U. Alvin, again, I'm going to start with you. Particularly, you have a key important role in leading student development, which prepares that place for the extracurricular opportunities for our students and their student experience.
Sure. Thanks, Provost Martin. I think first and foremost, you know, certainly there's a piece of this that is about recruitment, and we've done what we need to do in order to bring in this very diverse class. And now our focus really needs to be on the retention and the persistence of those students, and how we can go about creating a climate that really gives them the ability to be transformed by their educational experiences at Seattle University, but also, and most importantly, the opportunity to be successful and to thrive as a part of those experiences. And for me, that is about concrete actions and strategies that we can deploy that are really aimed at helping those students feel welcomed, feel a sense of home and a sense of belonging as a part of our campus community. And so the questions that puts in front of all of us, I think, are, you know, what are we doing individually and collectively to ensure that those students feel a part of Seattle University? What are we doing in the classroom? What are we doing in our clubs and organizations? What are we doing in our offices and departments? You know, how are we encouraging one another to work, you know, individually with students, but also collectively with this group of students to ensure that, in addition to the support that we provide as campus staff, faculty, and administrators, that they too, as peers, know how to support one another and can be engaged with one another in meaningful ways that give them the opportunity to really get to know one another, to understand who they are, to develop their identity, and to really become the kinds of students that we can be proud of and that we can ultimately push out into the world, having, you know, been made better and stronger than the students that we, you know, get on day one The last thing that I would offer as I think about this class and the students that are coming, you know, certainly we have work to do, as you noted, Provost Martin, around the development of our faculty and staff and bringing in more diverse faculty and staff. But in the meantime, you know, we certainly have to work with what we have. And that means, you know, looking inside and asking ourselves, am I personally equipped to support BIPOC students? Am I personally equipped to support students who are first generation? Am I personally equipped to support students who identify as LGBTQIA? Am I personally equipped to support students who come from low-income working class families? And if the answers to those questions aren't yes, then what is it that I need to do to make sure that I am prepared to support and to work alongside those students, again, towards the end of ensuring they have the best possible experience at Seattle University?
Thanks, Salvin. Father Steve, you've got the wisdom of your years of leadership, and this is an important question for the future of Seattle U. I'm wondering what your views are on it.
I think that our faculty and staff are better able to engage with this than they may think they are. And I think what is needed is the opportunity for them to be able to be together with one another, to talk through how they engage, whether in the classroom or in activities or in leadership or in service. They need to be supported by one another. I remember the instance, and I can't remember quite what provoked it. I think it may have been Charlottesville that Natasha offered at the very start of the year, just a regular kind of a dialogue with professors. And would you like to come and talk this through about how you engage with students in light of what's going on nationally? And she expected to have like 25 and she had like 100, and they had to move it to a different place because of the number of people that wanted to come. And it was the desire to be able to engage with students and to be able to meet them where they were and to know how to relate with them over the issues that they knew were going to be coming up. They just needed the opportunity among themselves to be able to be strengthened by one another for that. So I do think that we have much of the resources among ourselves if we can find the way in which we can mutually help and support one another and gain confidence in being able to know what we can do and how we can do it. The other thing, and I've talked to Alvin about this, is that, you know, when we're bringing in the kind of class that we are this coming year, when 32% of them are underrepresented minority students, which is, you know, it's more than double what it had been 10 years ago. That really is a question. Then, well, what kind of opportunities are we providing for mentoring those students? Many of them will be first generation students. Many of them will be students from families that don't have the kind of background that helps those students kind of navigate more easily. So I've talked with Alvin about, well, who are we mentoring among the Costco scholars? Who are we mentoring among the other groups that are coming to Seattle University along this line? It can't all fall to the Office of Multicultural Affairs, but it has to be divided among a lot of different people. But I'm not so sure that we're very good at identifying mentorship or advising in a general sense of advising of students when you have this kind of a diversity that is coming to our doors. So those would be a couple of things that I would think about.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Father Steve. David, you lead the College of Arts and Sciences, the largest college at Seattle University. How do you view this question?
Well, I think there was a slide that Natasha put up near the beginning that showed self plus systems equals transformation. And I think work, self-personal work and systems work are both critically important. This is not simply a matter of learning a content area, as so many areas are, and developing expertise and being able to share that in the classroom. This is about understanding better with a critical eye, where you are personally in the culture of racism that we are all in and have been in, raised in and lived in most of our lives, almost all of us, how that has affected you, where that's hit you, what you've done, and how you need to work on that, along with understanding the material, the history, the content, and looking at how we make systemic changes in our culture, in our curriculum, to represent these things, you know, sets of changes. It's going to take resource investment to do this, personal time and energy and budget. and putting those things together, it's a lot more comprehensive than the university trying to develop an expertise set, which we actually have in this area in a lot of ways. It's about everybody taking a critical look at themselves and in a way that an Ignatian tradition supports and encourages.
Yeah. So leverage the expertise we have and look at this comprehensively in all aspects of the university. Thanks, David. Sarah, let me turn to you next.
Thank you, Shane. Yeah, you know, for the Library and Learning Commons to advance equity, diversity, inclusion, anti-racism, we need to embed it in everything we do as a fundamental component. And that includes in our financial investments, so in the materials we buy, in our practices, policies, protocols, services, and so on. And library faculty and staff have set aside revising or updating their strategic plan. And this year we're going to launch an equity action plan instead of a strategic plan and really position us to focus and embed those values into everything we do. So it's a tall order. I think we can do it. And I also think it's essential.
Yeah, great. Sarah, thank you. Nicole, I'd love to hear your perspective on this.
Yes, Provost Martin. So, you know, I think Father Sundborg mentioned where we were a year ago. And I reflect back as a board when we watched together the video of made by our Black Student Union, which was incredibly powerful for our whole board. At that time, although we had adopted the strategic directions, you know, over a year ago that explicitly placed inclusive excellence as a core part of our future, the events of last year, the powerful, articulate female voices of our Black students calling out for help really propelled us to look at how we spend our time together. As I mentioned before, the framework of our decision-making is all based in our mission, where everyone is respected for who they are, their traditions, their background in our community. But we also made the decision to dedicate every single board meeting to prioritize our agenda around diversity, equity, and inclusion. We added three new board members during the course of the past 12 months, two of whom are persons of color and two of whom are women. And all three are outstanding business leaders in our community. And of course, we had fully support the action plan laid out in Lift SU. And, you know, we talked about data and numbers and how revealing that was around our student body. Numbers aren't everything, but they are very, very important. And if the board can continue working supporting the university leadership to baseline where we are today, to be clear about where our gaps are and where we really need resources and efforts to accelerate our work, and then how to measure our progress so that we can hold ourselves responsible and accountable. I think that's the role that the board can play at a governing level.
Yeah, no, Nicole, thanks for that. Eduardo, we so appreciate the way that you've engaged with us since you've been named our president-elect and even spent 3 weeks with us recently on campus. And so in some ways, this question is about your preliminary thoughts as you prepare to step into the presidency on July 1 in terms of where we go with closing some of these gaps and addressing some of the issues that are bubbling up today.
Thanks. You know, I wouldn't pretend to have, you know, all the answers. One thing that's really impressed me about Seattle University's approach to the really tumultuous year and a half that we've been through is the way that the Lift SU goals and action plan and isn't a kind of reactive effort that was sort of hastily thrown together in response to the events of the last 16 months. And I've seen that approach. The goal of creating an inclusive culture is fully in line with Seattle University's longer term aspirations and values. It's embedded in the strategic directions documents, as Nicole pointed out, and really is expressive of deeply held values at the university, which direct it to become a leader in creating an inclusive environment, inclusive pedagogy, and inclusive curriculum. So, Seattle University kind of comes into this several steps ahead of many other institutions. Obviously, you know, universities are really unique communities. There are no, you know, I think we forget this, right? There are no residential communities in this country that are more diverse or even as diverse across so many different dimensions as universities are. And this makes university communities uniquely challenging, sometimes uniquely tense and uncomfortable, but it also makes them really ideal places to grapple with these issues. I mean, one consequence of our diversity is that we have incredible intergenerational diversity, right? The faculty and staff are really in a different generation than our student body. Our country, as it goes through this moment of demographic change, very rapid demographic change, there's inevitably going to be a mismatch, you know, in the compositional diversity of the student body on the one hand and faculty and staff on the other. That's not an excuse, and it's not a reason not to really push ahead with our goals as creatively as we can. But it means, you know, that we're going to be reflecting that sort of transformational moment that our country is in a way that no other community is, right? And we can learn from that, and we can build on that. Father Steve mentioned mentorship and what we're doing on mentorship, and so going back 40 years, you know, when I was in college or in law school, the compositional diversity of the faculty and staff was even a step behind where it is today, right? And I had to find mentorship in my own professional life from people who didn't necessarily have the same sort of racial identity that I do. And I did. Some of the most important mentors in my life have been people who, you know, I find things that I share with them, but they're not of the same, they don't share all the same identities that I have, but that doesn't mean that they can't be effective mentors. And I think Alvin kind of mentioned this, that we need to make sure that we're preparing faculty and staff to serve in those really constructive and important kind of mentoring roles for our student body, even across differences of identity. And I think if Seattle University is doing that well, it'll help us bridge from, you know, this present moment of change and instability to a future where we more completely achieve these missions of inclusion and diversity at every level of the university.
Well, thanks, Eduardo. I mean, one of the things that I think about in my role as the chief academic officer is how our structures and our policies and practices can address our current situation and the future changing dynamics. You know, when you look at some of the numbers that we talked about earlier, I'm also very concerned about our retention rates and our graduation rates for all of our students, but particularly for our first generation students, our BIPOC students. And I think we have to ask ourselves, what does this generation of students need from Seattle U, and how can we respond? And that will, I think, necessitate our being willing to change policies and practices, some that we may not even be fully aware of how they become barriers for student success. As Eduardo mentioned, we've done well relationally, and yet we need to do better. We must do better. And so, there's a question in the question and answer that basically gets at this in another way, and it's, you know, how can a predominantly white group of leaders and a white group of professors really help move the needle on student retention and graduation for students of color? And as we think about the opportunities, I think we've got to get this structurally and also in multiple directions, including looking at the opportunities we have to diversify our faculty, our staff, and our leadership in the university, and how critical that is. Mechanism that a lot of universities use is some version of a diversity scorecard, which we've certainly talked about and embraced here in the past. And it could be a good opportunity to go deeper into the data and to try to get even further data around a diversity scorecard where we as leaders could truly set a bar for where we want to be in a few years. I am going to put forward one final question, although I don't know that we're going to have time for everybody to answer it. So I'm going to put this question out first and call on Father Steve, and then invite anyone that might want to speak to it. I was reflecting very much on the rich conversation between Professor Alexander and Vice President Martin. As I said in my introduction, I find Michelle Alexander's work to be primarily deeply spiritual, and I think that came across in the conversation today. One of the things that she talked about is the need to be in right relationship with one another, and that we need to acknowledge not simply the crisis around mass incarceration and the crisis around racial issues, but we need to acknowledge the spiritual crisis, and that we can't have authentic conversations without ourselves being authentic. Father Steve, in your experience, how has Jesuit education prepared to speak to and respond to what Michelle Alexander framed, and what might we need to think about in the future?
You know what, if I were to say what the biggest thing I took out of the dialogue there was Michelle Alexander herself and the kind of person that comes through there. I mean, it's a very indelible kind of an impact about who she is beyond what she's, you know, written and her experience has been. That's really impressive, the kind of person that she is. I think Jesuit education, the biggest thing that is there that needs to be developed further is to help students to learn how to discern their most important life choices. And if there's one thing that the Jesuits are about overall from the very beginning, from Ignatius de Loyola, the founder, is about discerning key moments in your lives and how do you go about doing that? How do you be present to yourself to know your own truth? How can you allow the deeper motivations and desires within you to come forward? I think that Jesuit education, we already do it significantly when our students say, gosh, how many reflection papers do you have to do? We're trying to slow students down and to get students to think. We're trying to get students to be present, not so much what's the amount of material that they need to know about a certain subject, but what can they do with it in terms of how they reflect on. If we could bring forward more in Jesuit education, the call to help students learn how to do discernment in their lives rather than discussion or deliberation simply or decision-making, it would be a great, great contribution of Jesuit education. And it's there in our tradition if we were just find a way to bring it forward more clearly.
And clearly, as Michelle talked about her own trajectory, discernment and deep reflection has been a key part of her story and narrative. So thanks for that. Would anyone else on the panel like to respond to that question? Are you moved? Just raise your hand. Yeah, Eduardo, go jump in. Great.
Yeah, no, I mean, you know what, I was really taken with her response to that question as well. And, you know, she said, I don't identify as Christian, but I thought her response was deeply Christian. Theologians talking about racism and white supremacy have kind of talked about it in many of the same terms that she used. They talk about it as really contrary to God's will, as a kind of idolatry. So in that sense, I see the goals, you know, of today's conversation as really fully in line with the Catholic and Jesuit identity of Seattle University. This idea that in the act of creation, God intended to create a single human family with all human beings created in God's image and sharing in God's dignity that comes with that. And over the summer, as we were going through the kind of revitalization of the movement for Black Lives, Fordham University professor, a priest, Brian Massingale, wrote an essay for the National Catholic Reporter and reminded us that on his last visit to the United States before he died, Pope John Paul II really called on Catholics to work to eradicate all forms of racism as part of their essential commitment to life. And he kind of linked the commitment to life to this commitment to fighting all forms of racism. And that's to say, you know, I think that he was instructing Catholics to not be indifferent to racism, right? To not be kind of silently non-racist, but to be actively working to combat racism wherever we find it. And, you know, if he were talking today, he would use the language of anti-racism, I think, to talk about that. And he made that a core Catholic commitment. So I think it's very much in not just in line with the Jesuit identity of Seattle University, but with its Catholic identity as well.
Well, thanks so much, Eduardo, on that. I know we're coming right, we've just passed our scheduled time here, and I want to be respectful of all the speakers today. I want to acknowledge there's a number of questions that we weren't able to get to live in this session, but that we will find a way to, in fact, address and make sure that we can continue this dialogue even beyond the summit. This has been a panel of leaders of the university. And so I want to thank you all as leaders. And very much speaking as leaders, we now want to have you all hold on. And Father Steve in particular, if you would just stand by here, and we would have a recognition here. I'm going to turn this to Natasha.
Thank you, Shane. I really appreciate the conversation. Thanks for facilitating it. And I want to thank each of our university leadership representatives, representative of other, you know, larger bodies, the full board of trustees, of course, with Nicole Piasecki and the cabinet with Father Steve at the lead of that. Our, you know, Dean's Council is represented by two of our deans, as well as pointing toward our future with our president-elect, Eduardo Peñarvea. So I am deeply grateful for you, your participation, and really helping us to think about shared leadership and what does that mean when we talk about those of us who lead the institution at the senior most levels and what that commitment looks like. So thank you so much. And with that, we have a special recognition for you, Father Steve. Given that you are retiring this year, really wanted to offer to you, next slide, the Inclusive Excellence Leadership Recognition for the Racial Equity Summit, the inaugural Racial Equity Summit. And Alvin Stoudemire is joining me in this leadership recognition. Father Steve, I really wanted to just take a moment as you are, you know, reaching the end of your leadership as president of Seattle U, but not your leadership in various other spaces and organizations that you're involved in being a voice within the Catholic Church and the Catholic communities that you're a part of for racial equity and inclusive excellence. I think it's important for our community to know that it was under your leadership that the Task Force on Diversity and Inclusive Excellence was commissioned. And Alvin Stoudemire and I together co-chaired the task force. And after my appointment as vice president, which you supported the establishment of that role, you and I embarked on a partnership together. I, you know, shared with you that I thought it was really important that modeling leadership around inclusive excellence should be modeled from the top, and that it was really important that our entire leadership team engage in doing its own exploration as individual members of a leadership team, as well as a collective. And you supported that. You leaned in. You supported and partnered with me for the entire cabinet to engage in a year-long, you know, leadership development around racial equity and racism and understanding the dynamics of difference so that we could build greater accountability into our university. And that was really meaningful. And we did a lot of things, right? You know, each of the cabinet members at the time who were on the cabinet took the Harvard IAT tests, and we had some discussions about that, right? Engaged in conversations with prominent thought leaders and equity professionals, including folks like Robin DiAngelo, which we had, you know, nearly a half day with her. And that was a challenging session. And but seeing you sort of as the leader set the tone for how we would move together through that was very meaningful. We had the opportunity to engage with scholars like Devin Carbato and to talk about the social construction of race. I remember you saying to me, well, you know, I really want to learn more about, you know, what is all of this social construction of race, right, about? So I just want to thank you for that. I also remember when you were preparing to give a talk for the prayer breakfast in Seattle, that we talked about that. You asked me for some recommendations of what, you know, how you should begin thinking about that. I suggested Michael Eric Dyson's book to you. You were open and engaged enough to, you know, take that recommendation, really read the book and connect with it and incorporate it into not only your prayer breakfast speech, but also you wrote an op-ed for the Seattle Times, right? So lending your voice from the position of your role as president has been very meaningful. And I want you to know that. And I think it's important for our campus to know that. We are not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but we are not going to get anywhere if we are not willing to take risks together. And that is precisely what you were willing to do as leader and to partner with me for that portion of our work. So I want to invite Alvin to share from his perspective and then maybe offer you maybe 1 minute, Father Steve, to say anything you'd want. I know we're kind of limited on time.
Thank you, Vice President Martin. Very briefly here, just a few words about your leadership, Father Steve, in the ways that you've shown up in this conversation around race, certainly within the 11 years that I've been at the university, and obviously I think a lot longer than that. I will offer that one of the primary reasons that I selected Seattle University back in 2010 was because of the opportunity I had to engage with you as a part of my interview experience. You perhaps may not even remember that, but I remember sitting in your office and having a really open and frank conversation about what it meant to be a person of color, assuming a leadership role within student development at Seattle University, and the kind of support that I could expect to receive as an administrator on this campus. And what I can say is that you certainly lived up to the expectations that I had in making the transition from St. Louis University to Seattle University, but most specifically, the level of support that I've received from you through the years, and in particular in the last 4 years in my time as Vice President for Student Development, especially in a time when there's been so much going on both on our campus and in the world that has directly impacted me personally. You've been a source of support, a source of strength, and I am grateful for the way that you've led. You know, Natasha spoke about the prayer breakfast and the talk that you gave at the breakfast. And that certainly, I think, is one of the more pivotal moments in Seattle history as it relates to race, particularly the way you sort of put yourself out there and talked openly and frankly about power and privilege and oppression and how it manifests in your life and the ways that you've been able to translate that into our campus. And so on behalf of all of us here at Seattle University, I offer my thanks and my gratitude to you for the leadership that you've provided.
Thank you. Thank you, Natasha. And thank you, Alvin. And yeah, we've been able to do a lot over these years together. There's a lot more to do, and I'm sure that Eduardo will help us take the university forward in that regard. That was the toughest talk that I gave in 24 years. It was the most one that took the most courage and the most preparation and the most thoughtfulness. I've gone back and looked at it and looked at the commitments there that I call for white people to have in regard to facing their supremacy. And I hope I live up to what I there proclaimed to other people. So there's nothing that could be a greater sort of a real recognition than simply what this whole day is, Natasha, in regard to, you know, coming to the end of my service and being able to have this racial equity summit of the quality that it is and the impact that it is. This really makes a big difference. So thanks very much. And I'm looking forward to the next little section. I'm really interested to see Ruth's artwork from the day, because I've been curious about that all day long. So
oh yeah,
I'm staying around. Thank you.
All right, great. Thank you, Father Steve. And congratulations. Peace and love to you.
Gotcha.
So we have one additional leadership recognition. This is the inaugural LiftSU Leadership Award that the Office of Diversity and Inclusion has developed. And this year, it was a really, really easy decision in terms of who would be recognized for leadership with respect to the pillars of LiftSU. And so for that, I am going to present this award. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Alvin Sturtevant, our Vice President for Student Development, who will welcome our esteemed honorees.
Let me begin by just acknowledging how honored I am to be present for this opportunity and to be in community with all of you today, and to be able to present the inaugural LiftSU Leadership Award in recognition of contributions to inclusive excellence on our campus and in our larger community. The Black Student Union, or BSU, under the leadership of Adelia Watson and Tatiana Summers and their advisors, Kalina Bruce and Lakeisha Kimbrough, is a model of excellence, vision, resilience, commitment, and speaking truth to power. Their leadership in creating and building the BSU scholarship represents the kind of effort that contributes to making Seattle University a more inclusive and equitable university. This has been a consequential year marked by a global pandemic, the deaths of so many Black and Brown citizens, including the killing of George Floyd, which catalyzed the largest social movement for Black lives in history. And at such a precarious time, the Black Student Union not only lamented the circumstances that brought about the horrific death of George Floyd, but also focused their efforts on solutions and modeled how the forces of change can ignite. Your leadership has ushered in a legacy that will bear fruit and impact the experiences of Seattle University students for years to come. And it is not lost on me, as I've said to the two of you before, that this labor came at the hands and on the backs of visionary Black women who sought to change hearts and minds, to shift policies, and to find solutions to some of the bigger problems that are in front of us as a campus. It is my honor, my esteemed pleasure, to present to you the inaugural LiftSU Leadership Award, one that is so deserving given all the work that you put forth, not only this year, but in the time that each of you has been at the university. Adelia, Tatiana.
Yeah, I just like to say thank you very much to less so, I'd like to say thank you to less so, you know, the white people that felt like supporting us was their way to contribute. More so the BIPOC people on this campus that were breaking their ass trying to doing more than they should, trying to educate and uplift BIPOC students, especially Black Student Union. This was an amazing year and it set the precedence for the work I'm going to do later on in my life. And this is a long time coming. I definitely wanted to start the scholarship because all of my financial aid came from scholarships, me doing weird and crazy things, trying to fund my education. And I want students later on to not have to worry about that because SU is a beautiful, wonderful school. I want to tie into the commentary on reflection because reflection is pivotal to my growth and especially into going into like my service. And I also would like to address some of these questions about people about this panel being mostly white. And I was kind of scratching my head about that too. I definitely agree that I uplifting like Black voices and just people of color voices in this panel should have been emphasized. I'm fine. I hope I'm not going to get in trouble for saying that, but yeah, I definitely think that should have been something more. But yeah, I appreciate that BSU is being presented this award, and that it won't just be BSU, that it'll be like Hawaii Club and all these other clubs on campus that center BIPOC being able to thrive, and then people of color on campus being able to thrive, and that this is a precedent of just a beautiful, immaculate future where statistics, diversity statistics on campus will be a lot different than when I graduated. I'm super proud of the work that Black women on campus have done, and I will be an involved alumni to know about what's gonna happen moving forward. So yeah, Tatiana, if you'd like to go.
Yeah, I just wanna take a minute to thank the committee for putting together this award and recognizing the hard work that BSU has done throughout the year. I also just wanna take a minute to especially emphasize my thanks to Adelia Watson. She has been an incredible president to work with, and I feel so lucky to be able to work under or alongside someone who's so passionate about bringing Black voices forward and amplifying BIPOC communities. I also want to take a minute to say that, you know, we've done a lot of work, but the work is definitely not done. And so Adelia, you know, is going to work on being a really involved alum. I hope that I can do the same. But we have to hold our university accountable, and we have to understand that it should be people who work for the university doing this work, not necessarily the students. And so it's very encouraging when I start seeing Dr. Sturdivant and Dr. Martin really holding their own and being more prominent in the university, because that's telling me that, you know, things are shifting and things are changing, and the conversation is changing in those higher up secret rooms. But I just, again, want to say thank you so much to everyone, and keep pushing, keep fighting. I'm going to drop the link to the BSU scholarship if anyone is wanting to donate. We are still trying to reach that $2,000 goal. I think we're at about 110 right now, or 115, somewhere around there. So still got a little ways to go, but yeah, thank you so much to the community and to everyone else.
Well, thank you so much, and congratulations on just your achievement. And certainly, as Dr. Sturdivant mentioned, it is not lost on us who has borne the brunt of the work for this. So I do want you to know that we see you, we are you, and we will carry forward your leadership and your work through this scholarship. So congratulations on graduating and soon, and the new beginnings for each of you. Thank you. Bye-bye. So now we are moving into the final segment of our Racial Equity Summit, but not the least of it at all. I am really excited to introduce or turn the summit over to Professor Jasmine Mahmood, who will be helping us to vision together for anti-racist education and providing a model, I think, for us to learn from. So, Professor Mahmood.
Great, thank you so much. Thank you, VP Martin, for this amazing event. It's really great to be with you all. My name is Jasmine Mahmood. I have a PhD in performance studies. I teach in the arts leadership program, part of the Performing Arts and Arts Leadership Department. I teach both undergrads and our graduate students that are training to work in the art sector. And for the past 2 years at Seattle University, I've taught a course called Black Lives Matter Art Theory Practice. I taught a first version of this course in 2017 when I was a postdoc at Washington University in St. Louis. So I lived in St. Louis. I moved there 2 years after Michael Brown's murder, and I found the city a place that was full of artists, especially Black artists, that used art to directly talk about issues of social justice and social change. And so the course kind of deals with these issues, thinking about kind of why Black art now, how Black art is in dialogue with the Black Lives Matter movement and movements for Black lives. So that's what I'm gonna talk about today. I hope you all are doing well. I know it's been a long day. And I'll say too, I know anyone that's been in my class before knows that I like to move my body. So I'm gonna kind of be vulnerable, encourage you all just to like stretch, because I know some folks have been sitting for a long time. So can we all just put our arms up in the air like this, and you can like shake them around and then turn to one side, and maybe there's a little crack in there, and then arms up again, and then turn to the other side. So with that, and the next, you can move to the next slide. Thank you. So I wanted to first talk to you all about kind of why the arts, why when we think about social change, should we center the arts? And in the next slide is from Michelle Alexander's book. Sorry to be, I'm gonna be this obnoxious person. Can I get the next slide? Awesome, thank you. So The New Jim Crow, Michelle Alexander calls this book The New Jim Crow, and she talks about why it's called The New Jim Crow, and it's from what she terms, I'll just read the first quote, Jim Crow, a term apparently derived from the minstrel show character. And then later she writes, towards the end of the book, it is difficult to look at pictures of Black people performing in minstrel shows during the Jim Crow era. It is almost beyond belief that at one time Black people actually covered their faces with pitch black paint, covered their mouths with white paint, drawn an exaggerated clownish smile, and pranced on stage for the entertainment and delight of white audiences who were tickled by the sight of a Black man happily portraying the worst stereotypes that justified slavery and later Jim Crow. So to me, this is important because it shows the central role of the arts in the United States in kind of violent systems of racism, but also as I'll get to encountering those violent systems. And can I get the next slide, please? So who was Jim Crow? Jim Crow, supposedly the lore tells us that in the late 1820s, early 1830s, there was a white actor named Thomas Danforth Rice based in New York City. And he supposedly went to the South during this time, and he supposedly saw a Black man perform, and he supposedly was so inspired by this that he burnt cork, smeared it over his face, and so began blackface performance. Blackface minstrelsy, often called Jim Crow minstrelsy, before the Civil War was mostly white people, often what we now consider kind of white immigrant populations that were doing this to assimilate to whiteness, performing Blackness. And this is important for at least two reasons, a gazillion reasons, including two reasons. First, it was important because blackface minstrelsy grew to become the most popular form of entertainment in the 19th century. At that time in the United States, theater took place in bars. So you would go to a tavern, get a beer, and there would be a white person performing in blackface on stage. So blackface minstrelsy was the most popular form of entertainment in the United States. It was the viral entertainment of the 19th century. And second, it's important, before the Civil War, this was white people making perceptions and representations of Blackness. And so thinking about these two things together shows you that at the time, and arguably today, the really pernicious power of the arts. Through theater, these racist stereotypes existed and exaggerated, were the most popular form of entertainment, such that harmful decisions like Dred Scott later would happen in the United States history. So thinking about that and thinking about kind of in this case, the harm of the arts in perpetuating racist stereotypes of Black people, but also the arts, and this is kind of what I study, hold power towards social change. And so can we go to the next slide? So this next slide is, I think most of you are really familiar with this. This is just two blocks away from Seattle University. This is the Black Lives Matter mural painted last summer, headed by Takiya Ward, who founded the Vivid Matter Collective. She's a Black artist, now works for the city of Seattle. And when the protests started happening, she reached out to 16 of her friends, one roughly, it's a little bit more complicated, but roughly one each to paint each of these letters. And so we can think about this Black Lives mural, and we can think about the power of this Black Lives mural. So a few different things to kind of name. First, for me, the reasons why art like this is so powerful is it clearly identifies the relationship between art and politics. When I think about art in my life, I often think about the term aesthetics. And aesthetics, one of the root of the word aesthetics comes from the senses. So to think about aesthetics is to think about how your senses are organized. And we can think here about how our senses are organized. And that word aesthetics, I think, is really interesting when it bumps up against this concept of politics. There's a theorist, Carolyn Levine, who defines politics as how order is imposed in the world. And so we can think about art, and the really amazing work of art is that it can disrupt our senses to have us think about and reimagine how order is imposed in the world. So that's one of the things that we can think about this with this mural. We can also think about this mural. And this week in my BLM class, we're reading Robin D.G. Kelly, who asks us, what are we dreaming towards? And the ways in which art helps us dream and helps us imagine. We can also think about this mural with the history, right? So it's painted last year, headed by Takiya Ward, a Black woman who was born and raised in Seattle, who worked with 15 other artists. And what does this history kind of mean for us in considering this work? We can also think about the particular aesthetics. So in my class, I've had students do aesthetic analysis of each of the letters and thinking about what does it mean to hone in, for example, on the V, which was painted by Aramis Hammer, who's a Seattle-based, she's a nurse turned artist in Seattle, does amazing mural work around the city. And thinking about, she uses kind of this yellow and grayish color in the V. What does it mean to think aesthetically about this work, especially to think aesthetically and materially about the work of Black artists so that their work is valued for the work itself in dialogue with who they are and not just because who they are. And last, to me, art is so important because it allows a place of joy. One thing that troubles me as a Black woman who was raised by parents who are, my dad converted to Islam, he's a Black Muslim. My mom is grew up Black Baptist. My parents, even though they deal with bullshit discrimination all the time, they love being Black. And they instill in me a pride and joy of being Black. And I think often when we talk about race, there's often kind of a challenging and an uncomfort, but I want there to be joy in this. And so one thing that arts does is allows us to think about that joy. And I'll just kind of name briefly in the class I'm teaching, we think about the Black Lives Matter movement. We read about the Black Lives Matter movement that was founded by three Black women, Alicia Garza, Patrice Cullors, and Opal Tometi. We read their originary statements. And then we look at the role of the arts and artists who've engaged the movement through visual art, through dance, through theater, through music, and through other genres as well. I'm gonna close my talk today featuring three of my students who's two of them have been in the class and one is a graduate student who's kind of doing work in dialogue with this. Because in this class, I also ask students, and they don't have to have any art background, to make art as well. And to think about what's the power that comes when we make art that's in dialogue with confronting racism, championing Black and championing Black community. So if we go to the next slide, and this is actually work by Ruth, who is an amazing artist. And Ruth was a student in my BLM class last year. And so I'm gonna actually turn it over to Ruth if she's there to tell us a little bit about her art.
Yeah, hi, hey guys. So yeah, I am, for this art piece specifically, the task was just kind of doing a piece of art that embodies some of the themes that we talked about in class. And one of those themes was about Black grief. And so I decided to do kind of like a quick digital kind of collaged image of a Black mother laying on her deceased son's bed and just kind of showing kind of that body language and that that moment in time of the grief of what she feels, you know, and with the, memorial being kind of framed within that sort of windowsill and the pieces of art and his room kind of messy. It just kind of gives kind of the realism of what is kind of left behind when Black sons are murdered and Black moms are left to kind of sit in what was left of their legacies. So, yeah.
Thanks so much, Ruth. And it's really good to see your face and I'm excited for your mural sketch. So we'll go to the next slide. This is another student who's in my class. This quarter, Xavier Kelly is an amazing visual artist. This work is called Nervous System Self-Portrait. He is an art major, acrylic and marker on canvas. You can see the dimensions. It was made this year. And then he wrote, I have students describe their work and to practice not just the work, but also how do we talk about art, especially Black art. He wrote, "This piece depicts my nervous system communicating with my brain, muscles, and other parts of my body in order to accomplish a jump. This piece is a metaphor for the overdevelopment of Black people's flight, fight response from being hunted in this country." And so we can all just take in this work and really think about the ways in which this work is communicating these ideas that Xavier Kelly is expressing. And then one last piece, if we can go to the next slide, is this is by Ade Abatan. And Ade is actually a graduate student in our MFA Arts Leadership Program. This work is called Dance in the Deep, made in 2020. You see the dimensions and the material. And Ade writes, "Dance in the Deep was made in April, just after the stay-at-home orders had been issued due to the COVID-19 pandemic. In my journal, I had written, 'I will dance, unfettered and unbothered, like summertime, when this is all over.' Too often people of color are defined by their suffering. However, this piece captures the desire to move in purpose and mindfulness and celebrate the joy that is also part of the human experience." So that's just a little bit about art. And I hope I leave with you thinking about the ways in which art sensorially organizes us to imagine new worlds. And also I'll say, I was in class this morning, I was teaching, and part of it, there was a talk about Jacob Lawrence and his migration series, and how him documenting that series of Black people moving from the South was kind of one of the only Black author documentation of that movement. So thinking about art as a space that sensorial orients us to imagine, but also archives histories that are often erased because of systems of white supremacy and other forms of oppression. So thanks for listening to arts about arts and racial equity. And thanks again, VP Martin, for all your amazing work organizing this today.
Thank you, Professor Mahmood, and all of the students who participated with you. That was just a wonderful way to think about visioning together for anti-racist education. And I was really struck by the idea of bringing joy, which reminds me of Adrienne Marie Brown's book, Pleasure Activism. And so I really want to thank you for that. I think it's a wonderful kind of model to think about how we actually embed anti-racist principles into our teaching here at Seattle University. So now it is time for the big reveal with our resident artist, Ruth Zacharias.
Yes, hi guys again. Yes, Ruth Zacharias, graduating in 2022, biology major. Yeah, so this is kind of what I've gotten so far. I'll pull it up a little bit closer. But so far, I feel like it's flipped, so I'm also sorry about that. But right now, I just kind of have one of the key themes that keep popping up for me, and what was the definitely one of the most important things said during today, and which was lift every voice. And that I think would be probably the thing that stuck the most in my head from every talk, from every moment, every element kind of described what it meant to bring all voices in together. And so hopefully when this comes into fruition, these faces will have color. The background would be full of vibrant color streams, and the lettering would be a lot more visible. But this sketch, I hope, is just a little bit of the piece that I feel that today kind of embodied and what I hope for our future to look like. So yeah, thank you.
Wonderful, Ruth. Thank you so much. It is amazing that you were able to develop and express in real time the sentiment of the summit from your perspective as an artist. Deeply, deeply grateful for you. And I want to let everyone know that the intention was not that Ruth would have a finished product by the end of the summit, right? Art takes time. And so she will be receiving from the Office of Diversity and Inclusion a LiftSU summer grant to complete this wonderful piece of art that will then become part of our story as Seattle University, as it relates to racial equity and anti-racism, and related to LiftSU, in particular, our pillar around narratives through art and symbols. And we will find a very special place for it, Ruth, in the institution. So thank you very much. And I look forward to seeing the finished work. So here we are, my colleagues. We have reached the end of the road together, almost. We're almost there. I want to thank you for your patience, for being steadfast in your participation today. And it's been inspiring and eye-opening for me and as your Vice President for Diversity and Inclusion. And I hope it has been the same for you. I think it's really important for us to remember and think of our university systematically and as an ecosystem. And so we all make up that ecosystem and have a responsibility for maintaining its health and flourishing. Our now current Vice President, Kamala Harris, has said, as this slide denotes, next slide, please. It is important for us to remember that unlike COVID-19, in trying to rid our world, our country, our cities, and our states of COVID-19, we are reaching the point where we have the blessing that so many of us may be vaccinated or have the capacity to be vaccinated. But for racism, there is no vaccine. The fact of the matter is that we have to do the hard work to bring it to fruition. And so we're going to have to ally for solidarity. I was so inspired by that earlier panel. We have to have fewer only ifs and more of what can I do myself to be more accountable as an ally. And as Ijoma Oluo, the writer of So You Want to Talk About Race, has noted, you don't have to be free of racism to actually have a commitment to fight racism. So I want to leave you, my colleagues, with one final reflection. Next slide. And that really is thinking about who we want to be. Who do we want to become? So the writer Chimamanda Adichie has written this. Stories matter. Many stories matter. Stories have been used to dispossess and to malign, but stories can also be used to empower and to humanize. Stories can break the dignity of a people, but stories can also repair that broken dignity. Chimamanda Adichie. So we are going to write a new storyline for Seattle U, for our students' experiences with us. And so I ask you, who do we want to become? What's the next chapter of our inclusive excellence journey? What will that evolution look like? It will take all of us. I want to extend my deepest gratitude to all of you who participated in this program today, all of you who supported this program, and all of you who attended the program. Now I will turn it over to our master of ceremony to take us through the end.
Thank you, Natasha, for sharing those powerful words. I'm excited to introduce our next reflection as we close our art and action section. It's a tongue twister. But Father Arturo will come to us. He is the rector of the Jesuits at Seattle U and an accomplished artist. And so he's going to give us a closing reflection. Father Arturo.
Thank you so much for the invitation. I am here standing as many others in solidarity. A racial equity summit is a pause. It is an exam in the Ignatian tradition that allows us to recognize and celebrate all the good things we already receive as a gift. Truth telling. It is also a moment to envision before God the work we are still called to do to reach the full potential of God's grace and modify our unpolished ways of saying and doing through seeking. It is in a way an exam of our authenticity. This summit is a time to reposition our strategies and actions. In the Ignatian tradition, we are called to recognize how God is working and the tendencies and through the tendencies and polarizations that God's Spirit introduces in history. It is an opportunity to allow the same Spirit to come through. Not in vain, this summit happens before the Feast of Pentecost, which is the Feast of the Holy Spirit in the Christian tradition that will happen this coming Sunday. This summit is the preparation we need to receive the light, the joy, the strength, the healing power, the gift of discernment, and the mission to keep fighting for a more just world in which we are called to live in peace and recognize that we are brothers and sisters of the same Father, Mother, who created us different in colors and cultures to manifest his joyful creativity and love for humanity. I would like to conclude my participation by calling a beautiful prayer of Martin Luther King. Shake us from our slumber. When our eyes do not see the gravity of racial justice, shake us from our slumber and open our eyes, O Lord. When our fear, we are frozen into inaction, give us a spirit of bravery, O Lord. When we try our best, but say the wrong things, give us the spirit of humility, O Lord. When the chaos of this dies down, give us a lasting spirit of solidarity, O Lord. When it became easier to point fingers outwards, help us to examine our own hearts, O Lord. God of truth, in your wisdom, enlighten us. God of hope, in your kindness, heal us. Creator of all people, in your generosity, guide us. Racism, break your heart. Break our hearts, for what breaks yours, O Lord? Ever-present God, you call us to be in relationship with one another and promise to dwell wherever two or three are gathered in our community. We are many different people. We come from many different places. We have many different cultures. Open our hearts that we may be bold in finding the riches of inclusion and the treasures of diversity among us. We pray in faith. Amen.
Thank you, Father Arturo. That was quite powerful. And, you know, what can I say? This whole day, this summit experience from beginning to end has been just so full. I'm full. And I pray that this first racial equity summit at Seattle U will not be the last. Well, there are so many people to thank and to just to give honor and respect and gratitude for their participation in this awesome program. You can see their names. I think we have their names listed. There are so many people to name. So I'm just going to say to all the faculty, the staff, the student panelists, the musicians, Freshmade Studios who helped to make the tech part all possible. We can't forget our artist in residence, Ruth Vicarious. The folks at ODI, Diversity and Inclusion, Amber Larkin, Marquinta Obamanu, I'm trying to get your name right, girl. And of course, Natasha Martin, Vice President for Diversity and Inclusion, whose vision for the Racial Equity Summit, it just surpasses all of my hopes. And so we're just so grateful for ODI. And we cannot forget to thank Michelle Alexander. Wow. As we say in my tradition, what an awesome and powerful word. We are so grateful for her prophetic teaching and for her invitation for us to continue doing this work. But most of all, we want to thank you. We want to thank you for coming out, for such a time as this. We thank you for your earnest participation, for your personal reflection time, for your thoughtful questions and your insights. And we know, we recognize that this has been a hard year, a hard 16 months, right? This has been a consequential year. The isolation, the loss, the violence, there's just been so much with all that has transpired. So we hope that you have been inspired, that you have learned something new, that you have strength now for the journey. And so we must remember that we are all in this together as we pursue racial equity and anti-racism on behalf of this university and all the communities of which we're a part. We hope that you have learned that each of us, in fact, has a part to play in continuing to write our story of inclusive excellence at Seattle U. This is the new story that we need to tell, not to ignore our past history and the realities of injustice.
Okay, colleagues, I believe we were hearing such profound words from our master of ceremony, Reverend Victoria Carr Ware, whose feed I think has slipped a little bit. But I'm gonna send you off in the same spirit that she was sending us off, and just say to everyone, the power of the place that is Seattle U is within our hands. This summit is not an end in itself. We didn't anticipate to solve the problem of structural racism here today. But what we did set out to do was to strengthen our resolve, learn something new, as Victoria Carr Ware shared, and to gain clarity of purpose for the journey. So thank you, my colleagues. Please be safe and be well. I look forward to extending this work with you in the fall and throughout next year. I will be working with the Center for Faculty Development, who will be partnering to put together some opportunities for us to extend this work into the fall. We'll also be working with Professor Rachel Luff to extend opportunities to dig deeper into allyship as well. And I look forward to those opportunities. So stay safe and be well, and peace.